Alan Peter and Peter's brother Lafcadio shambled into Leary's house in Newton Center, just like they shambled into everywhere. Beat. Lafcadio was on leave from his latest mental hospital. Peter was still beautiful, spacey, trailing a stream of non sequiturs and spontaneous poetic observations. Ginsberg sported heavy black eyeglasses with a cracked left lens. However, Ginsberg, being Ginsberg, the crack wasn't simply a crack. The crack had a story of its own. The crack paralleled a five-month-old fissure in Ginsberg's consciousness. The crack was hard won and carried its own symbolism, which Alan was only just starting to assimilate into his ever-evolving worldview. Alan felt that it was important for Tim to know where the crack, figurative and literal, had come from. If Tim was going to act as their tripping guide, their curandero, then Alan wanted to inform him about his set and the battering it had taken in Pocapa, Peru. The morning after the beat group arrived, Alan sat at the kitchen table across from Tim and told him the abridged story. He wanted to give enough information for Leary to appreciate what he had just experienced. But properly told, fully told, the story of the cracked eyeglasses begins with William S. Burroughs in 1951 and winds like an ayahuasca vine through pre-Leary Harvard. Among many other influences, William S. Burroughs is credited with turning the beats onto drugs. Born in 1914 to a prominent St. Louis family, Burroughs attended Los Alamos Ranch School in New Mexico for part of high school, until a series of conflicts with the authorities who ran the school, as well as with his schoolmates, landed him back in St. Louis. While at Los Alamos, he also kept track of his first homosexual crushes in his journals. Burroughs finished high school back in St. Louis and, still living out the blue blood plot, entered Harvard University in 1932. See, more Harvard, they don't like this. He graduated Harvard in 1936 and began receiving a $200 monthly allowance from his parents. While the amount was by no means extravagant, it did allow Bill some freedom from constant financial pressures. One might even speculate that the freedom allowed him the leisure time to become bored. And as Geoffrey Chaucer wrote in 1386, idleness is the root of mischief. By the time Alan met him, the older Burroughs was already a fixture around the junkie hangouts of Times Square. Alan, still a student at Columbia, was fascinated by Burroughs' outlaw lifestyle and impressed by the depth and breadth of his reading and intellect. Soon Burroughs took on the role of mentor to Alan and Jack Kerouac. He turned them on to new books and philosophies, even going so far as to psychoanalyze each of them in his apartment. Burroughs also turned them on to speed by way of Benzedrine inhalers and to the internal slowdown of heroin. Burroughs was a lifelong opiate user and was always fascinated by drugs. He also studied anthropology at Harvard and Columbia and later added courses on archaeology and ethnology at Mexico City College in 1950. Somewhere along the way, most likely through the book Fantastica by the German pharmacologist Louis Lewin, Burroughs learned about Yahe, also known as ayahuasca. As with Burroughs, Alan's first Yahe experiences were not pure enough to get the full effect. But when Alan eventually drank the potion and found himself face to face with the vomiter, he knew he was in the full throes of a Yahe trip. Alan had already experienced peyote, LSD, mescaline, and an array of other drugs, but Yahe felled him like no other. The universe in the form of the vomiter came to Alan as a horrible, destructive, dark, uncaring force. This was no peace and love trip. Much as with his early Blake visions, this Yahe trip would stalk Alan for the rest of his life. And in addition to the mental and spiritual terrors, Alan had also managed to crack the lens of his eyeglasses on that trip. This was the Allen Ginsberg that Leary sat with in his kitchen. Inspired and informed by the intrepid work of two other Harvard men, Schultes and Burroughs, and fully aware that he was on the historical turf of William James, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Henry David Thoreau, and numerous other radical intellectuals, Ginsberg looked out at Leary through the cracked lens of his eyeglasses and told him about the vomiter and his other Yahe and hallucinatory experiences. Tim understood and appreciated that Alan was explaining his particular set and the hope that it would help Leary act as a better curandero for him. Once the set was clear, it was time to prepare the setting for Alan's trip.